way of doing business, what I have summed up in a very mundane manner, you may call it a humor in uniform, not uniform of services, but uniform of the corporate world. One, managing both the mismanaged and mismanagement. Two, jugaad. And three, tossing up peers and perks together. Do you confirm this or you do not confirm this?
Jugaad. So yes, India is known for jugaad in a very, very big way. But I have also studied and included in my book examples of very, very structured and innovation processes on research and development that many of these companies have done. For example, how Hindustan Unilever came out with the Pureit water supply. It's a fantastic example of the investments that a company has made in order to make purified water available at very, very low cost, where there is no electricity, where there is no continued supply of water, where there is a quality of water available which is at par with WHO standards and which is available at a pittance of a cost, so that the poorest of the family in the rural areas can buy it.
That's it.
So there are examples of jugaad. There are examples of very, very structured research and development. But I always try to highlight this diversity and, as you said, manage the mismanaged. There is mismanagement, there is a lot of it, because we are evolving as a corporate entity.
Thank you so much.
That's so thank you for highlighting that. And yes, the second part you said,
third is very important.
Yes, that's why I wanted to come to that.
There is peer and perks tossed together.
Yes.
What I mean is, peers is the collaboration
yes.
of your peers and
yes,
everybody,
yes.
and perks is what you give to society
yes.
and what you take from society.
Perfect. Yes, that's well summed. That's what I was trying to say, that how you can take everybody along to ensure that their interests are taken care of. Mary Parker Follett gave a very standard definition which we study in management. Management is the art of getting things done through others.
Absolutely.
I don't think so. Management is not the art of getting done through others. Management is the art of leading the way and showing by example. I guess that is what all of us as NDIM stands for, that you create leaders. Leaders show and stand by example, not get work done by others and then relax and say, he's doing and she's doing. That's not a sustainable way of it.
Thank you very much.
So thank you for highlighting.
Thank you very much. And
thank you for the nice lecture.
You're welcome, sir.
I'm working as Deputy Secretary of the Ministry of Human Resources.
Okay.
See, my concern is about 2022. See, two concerns. One is about inclusiveness. See, we are talking about Bangalore, Delhi, Bombay and others.
Yeah.
What about decentralization? What about migration from Bangalore? Why Bangalore? Why Delhi? Why Mumbai?
Yes, very good.
Number two, you have skipped a very important area, sustainability. Sustainability. What about sustainability? How it is going to sustain? And see, how it is going to sustain? That is a very important question. One is, we need to migrate. We need to increase the population. See, urban to rural, urban to village. See, why only important cities like Delhi, Bombay, and Bangalore? And then sustainability.
Yes.
And then third, very important issue is, see, I am from MHRD, I am there for the last 5 years. What about education, real education, value education? What about ethics? See, you are saying that human dividend. What about human? I think it is going to be human bound. The way many things are moving, I find sometimes you are over-optimistic. Over-optimistic. I think India will not develop for another 60 years. Maybe some plus points are there in the startups and other thing. But you see the real poverty. Real poverty is about 80%, strictly good. And then I also want to say about the CSR. Why can't it be CSRD? Responsibility and duties. And then you mentioned about the 500 crores and 5,000 crores. Why can't the corporates pool the funds? Pool the funds. And what about international CSR? International CSRD. And lastly, I want to ask one question, since you are the management institution. One last question. See, I want to ask you, suppose management institution, see, is there any meaning in MBA without technical knowledge? How successful a manager will be without technical knowledge? See, when you talk about digitization, etc., as a management student, if I don't know the ins and outs of digitization, how will I be successful? I think in today's era, in technology era, we need both science and management. What is your take on that? And lastly, what about the world-class institution? We don't have a single world-class management institution, whether it's IIM or Indian School of Business. What about the world-class institution? Do you foresee any world-class institution in India like Albert? Thank you very much.
gentleman has asked me 7-8 questions in one round. So I'll try my best to answer all of them, and they're very pertinent points. Starting with sustainability, as I mentioned in the beginning, in my book and my research, I have covered 7 stakeholders. So the environment is a very, very critical stakeholder. And when you talk about sustainability, you're talking about issues connected to the ecology and 4 to 5 different kinds of pollution. I have elaborated that in ample detail in my book with lots of examples of how environment, sustainability and ecology need to be integrated into the business model. I have given example of how when Hindustan Unilever and Nirma were on a war for their low priced product, what research, and I'm not trying to put in multinational versus an Indian bred organization, it's not about patriotism versus an MNC, it's about an idea. How Hindustan Unilever, before trying to provide a product which matches Nirma for the rural population, did research and ensured that the wheel product which they bring to the market is such that even when it is used in the rural water bodies, it does not leave behind chemicals, because the same water body is used by cattle, the same water body is used for bathing, the same water body is used for drinking. So it is not that you will pollute the water body and then you will have a cleansing process and environmental issues will be taken care of. These issues have to be integrated into the business. So that's a very valid point, and sustainability is a very important aspect. Because I have 35-40 minutes, I have just covered the tip of the iceberg. If I have to cover all of that, I need a series of lectures for a fortnight, and I can cover each of them in ample detail. Today I just thought I'll cover customers. So one very valid point. Secondly, we are talking about values. Yes, very, very important. Human values are the core of education. It is said in Sanskrit, Vidya Dadati Vinayam. Without humility, education is waste, because it's only a tree which bears fruit bends the most. If you have as many degrees on your shoulders and as many medals in your pockets, the humility levels need to be as higher. Only a barren tree will stand erect with arrogance because it doesn't have anything to bow down to. So these values have to be ingrained in the individual at multiple levels. From the time the child is born, it is the parents' responsibility. When the child goes to school, it is the kindergarten teacher's responsibility. From the child goes to higher secondary school, it is the school's responsibility to create an ambience where the right role models are placed before the students. I'm sorry to say, and I have nothing against Bollywood, all of us watch Bollywood movies. But today, our heroes and heroines are film stars. 2 generations earlier, the heroes and heroines were Mahatma Gandhi, Sardar Patel and Subhash Bose. Because these people had set an example in their real life. The dearth in India today is lack of real role models, and that's why the celluloid role models are presumed to be the same in real life and hence become our role models. So the examples of exemplary citizens who have been created by this country need to be placed before individuals. And it doesn't end there. Values is not the responsibility of the school education system. Even in higher education, in colleges, in technical education, and I mentioned that today in the interview to HT, even in research, how much of investment is made in research so that we have good turnaround of PhDs. But how many of those PhDs are adorning the shelves of libraries, and how many of those PhDs have got converted into social outcomes which are going to benefit the society? After all that money is being invested so that it gives some outcome to the society which is investing in those individual research projects. So values is an inherent component. It is right. It is like the roots of the tree which give it the foundation that have to be an inherent part of the education system. Thirdly, you mentioned about migration and why big cities, why not the rural areas? Of course, the rural areas are very important, and I always remember President Kalam when he talks about Pura. You are saying it will take 60 years for India to become developed. President Kalam in all his wisdom said 2020. So it's not about years, but it's about a vision. And definitely preventing migration is a very important objective. But it is not a slogan that, oh, we'll prevent migration. You need to create an ecosystem in the rural areas. And that's what I've done through the project for which I'm the project director. That in the rural areas, we've made an attempt that those crafts enterprises which are supporting livelihoods, for example, in the Indian craft sector, there are organizations that we've supported, we've worked with, who have established check dams, who have constructed check dams, who have constructed, who have conducted healthcare camps, who have supported primary healthcare centers and primary education institutions, so that the entire social ecosystem is established, so that that concern gradually reduces and the individuals have time to contribute to commercial and economic self-sufficiency through the livelihood track. So it's an integrated approach which will have to be followed. And the government is attempting to provide an ecosystem, but it cannot be a standalone. You're asking about what about industry bodies contributing to it. I would like to confess that in 2 years, to expect that all of a sudden changes will come with the CSR money and all the differences between companies will vanish, industries will come together, CII will say, I'm Bhishma Pitama, so I will tell you what you should do, and all others will be the 105 brothers of the Kuru clan and they will listen to him. That's not going to happen. It is an evolutionary process. In my research, I have seen it will take time, but there are examples. There's an example of Larsen & Toubro, which started the Construction Skills Training Institute in 2000. And seeing the success of that, the construction industry in Andhra Pradesh got together, established the National Academy of Construction, which was supported by the government of Andhra Pradesh, now the government of Telangana, and they have all the industry members of different construction companies working on NAC, establishing 6, 8, 10 different training centers across the state, and have now got about 1.25 lakh pass outs every year who have been trained in plumbing, in carpentry, in electrification, and these people get jobs in Middle East, get jobs in different parts of the country and the world, and they are becoming self-sufficient. I have seen, when I have gone to Tamil Nadu, I went to study some of the villages in the Srinivasan Services Trust, which has worked with women through the SHG route. They've got 400,000 women empowered, and I met one or two SHGs. They had started poultry rearing, cattle farming, and this basket making kind of initiatives. The corporation didn't give them money. They gave them inputs. This is the way to raise a loan. This is the way to run the business. These are the skills you need. They help them make a profit. They help them repay the loan. They help them get another loan. They help them increase the market share of their products and go from there. Those ladies in their Tamil told me when I got the translation that we had no education. We were living in the rural areas. But my son is studying in engineering college in Madurai. My daughter is doing bachelor's of arts in Coimbatore. And they will now get jobs in the cities. They don't have to come back here. My life's objective is achieved. So there are a lot of these islands of inspiration and prosperity which are existing in India. It will not take 60 years. It will take 600 years if efforts are not made in the right direction. So I guess, yes, I'm optimistic, and I think it's time that this generation has optimism, because it is only optimism which will give results. If our 80% of the day is going to be spent in finding faults with the system, and the 20% of the day is used in personal comforts, there is no time to make a change. And as JFK said in America, even now it's appeared on Howard Kennedy School, tell me what you can do for the country, not what the country will do for you. It's not an election slogan, but it's the way a country operates. It has to be a bottom-up approach, and it has to be a top-down ecosystem. I'm so glad that in this country, when there are real serious problems, there is so much of unity in society that in this same Delhi, people were almost on their way to Rashtrapati Bhavan when that unfortunate event happened on that fateful night, which is now known as Nirbhaya. So we have an enlightened citizenry which is becoming increasingly literate and conscious of their duties and their responsibilities. So CSRD that you said is also very, very visibly emerging. And you mentioned about entrepreneurship. I feel this generation is increasingly becoming entrepreneurial. If you study the reports of IITs and IIMs, there is a big chunk of the pass-outs or the graduates who are attempting to do social well-being projects at a for-profit basis. And the issue of not having world-class institutions, you said like Harvard, let me just confess one thing. Harvard is a 400-year-old institution. It is older than the Constitution of the United States of America. So the Harvard of the world...
I didn't mention Harvard. I didn't mention
you separate salaries. So you may want to take up education as a profession in case of, instead of going into the corporate world. And that's why you are able to attract best students. That's why you're able to get good placements. That's why you're able to get corporate support. And that's why you're able to get best teachers. It's a virtuous cycle. And this virtuous cycle needs to be sustained. In India, the issues are multiple. There are many government-supported institutions. Government have their own limitations and compulsions. There are issues of funding and support. So it's a big ecosystem issue. But I'm seeing a lot of positives and things happening. Today the IIM bill has been passed. The IIMs have become autonomous. They will now be able to issue degrees instead of diplomas. Now it took 11 years for this idea from ideation to fructification just to make IIMs autonomous. But this is the strength and the limitation of a democracy like India. See, we are all proud to be in a democratic institution. We have to inherit the slow pace at which decisions are taken. But it's also the advantage that when decisions are taken, they are acceptable to all at large. It's not thrust from the top that this is what you have to do. Like China's single child policy. You don't have a choice. You can have only one kid. One generation later, it turns out into a demographic nightmare. So you said, okay, now you can have two kids. Technical inputs before you get into management education. That's an interesting point. In US and other developed countries, management degree is given only when you have 3 to 4 years of work experience. That provides them the technical grounding before you get a management degree admission. Fortunately or unfortunately in India, the pattern is different because here, it's like, degree ho gayi, abhi job le lo. Job ho gayi, toh degree nahi lena kyunki shaadi karna hai. Ghar sambhalna hai. So the entire perspective is different. I guess these things will evolve as the requirements of the industries change, and it's a valid point.
Thank you, sir.
I just have one question.
Yes.
You mentioned that we look to West for solutions. The reason is that the modern economy, modern global economy and national economy are only 200 or 300 years old after the Industrial Revolution.
Yes.
So the West has more experience in it. That's why the reason why we take examples from the West. But I think an approach where our own indigenous solutions, if we can amalgamate them with the West and not totally exclude the West, we would be very well off.
No, of course, for heaven's sake, please don't think that I said turn your eyes closed towards the West and India is the best. No, the moment you stop learning, that's the beginning of the downfall. So your point is very valid, and that's what I meant when we say that TVS went for the Deming Prize. Now, who brought in the rigor of the Deming Prize? It's the Japanese engineers. And they learned from that. And the Japanese engineers and the Deming team from Japan came and complimented TVS that you've not only implemented our ideas, but you have contextualized it to your Indian requirements. So what you said is exactly what I've covered in the book. We need to take the tools and techniques of the West. We also need to contextualize them in India. And we also need to, from that, come up with an Indian way which those who do not have the capacity to balance the two can get a ready-made solution which can then be multiplied and expanded. So please do not think that we should not look to the West. Please continue to look to the West, but please also continue to experiment on your own and find your own novel ways to succeed. Because you never know, the Indian mission to Mars was the first, the cheapest and successful at the maiden attempt, which was not by any of the other countries. So you never know where the solutions come from, and there are a number of examples in our own lifetime where India has done very well. So you need to be balanced between the East and the West and be proud of your heritage and what capacities that you are endowed with. I guess that's why today in the West, in the Silicon Valley, you have Satya Nadella, you have Sundar Pichai, you have all these top company leaders from the Indian background. And let me confess, they have had their basic education in India. They are products of the Indian IITs and the IIMs. The dean of Harvard Business School is a product of the Indian education system. The professors that I have worked with are products of the Indian education system. So we may not have world-class educational institutions, but we've definitely groomed individuals or provided an ecosystem where individuals with world-class aspirations have made the most of the system and propelled themselves ahead. I guess that's the example we can.